Welcome to the INSS 13th International Annual Conference. With me today is Ambassador Barbara Leaf, was the US Ambassador to the United Arab Emirates from 2014 until 2018, and today is a fellow at the Washington Institute and the Director of the Program on Arab Politics. During her diplomatic career, Ambassador Leaf served as a high-level positions in the State Department. She served as the Deputy Assistant Secretary on the Arab Peninsula, on Iraq issues, in the past also on Iranian issues. She was positioned around the world, including in Jerusalem.
Yes.
And in 2010, when she was a political minister counselor at the U.S. Embassy in Rome, Italy,
yes,
she was called to Iraq, to Basra, where she was directing the U.S. provincial reconstruction team in a very tense situation and I would say life-threatening even place. And I would like to talk a little bit about Iraq.
Mm-hmm.
The focus seems to be, when we're talking about U.S. and Iraq relations, is on the military aspect, the counter-Iran operations. And I wanted to talk a little bit about a different angle about the U.S. role in the deconstruction of Iraq, the attempts to reconciliation in Iraq. What do you think is the U.S. role there? Can it have a role? Is it does it have enough trust to continue to play a positive role in these areas?
Well, I have to believe so. And I think the Iraq of 2020 is a very different country, a very different society of the Iraq of 2003 or 2010 when I was there. Iraq has changed and morphed every year, and in no small part because it has a phenomenally young population. Something on the order of 65% of the population is under 30. So that means it doesn't have a memory of events from the 90s, sanctions, Saddam Hussein, or even much of the early parts of the U.S. Invasion, occupation of Iraq. That said, it's in a profoundly complex society, and you see it in a tremendous state of churn right now. It is very important for us as Americans to look beyond the military dimension of this relationship. And indeed, that is what Iraqis want from us. They want the benefits of U.S. economic engagement, commercial engagement, and yes, help in getting them through a very difficult passage that they are entering upon.
What is the U.S. doing in this regard?
So right now, it's a very tough operating environment. A good friend of mine is our ambassador in Iraq. I was texting with him the other day, and he said, you know, it's a funny situation when you find yourself, as I do, that some Iraqis want to give you messages by sending rockets and mortars at you. So the situation that Iraq is in is one of churn, not only because of the demonstrations in the streets since October, but as importantly, the effect of these militias in Iraq and their effect on governance. And these are, of course, the byproduct or the direct legacy of Qasem Soleimani. So what the U.S. is doing is a large agenda, but it's a very constraining environment for us to operate in right now.
And what about funding? Is the U.S. continuing to supply? Is there enough funding to also assist economically?
Well, I think we're in a different, we're not in the position of devoting a lot of economic assistance. We do have some programs, of course, for needy communities and for IDPs, for refugees from the conflict over ISIS. Iraq, you have to remember, is the fourth largest oil producer in the world. It has the fourth largest energy reserves or oil reserves in the world. It is not, in effect, a poor country, although it is poor in the way it is governed.
Okay.
So much of what we have to do is help Iraq come out of this isolation and reintegrate it into the wider, not just the region is important, but also the wider international community, and help them get through a passage wherein they have to create the conditions for investment and for growth of the private sector. And that is a very tough order.
And do you think that the Iraqi people on the street, do they see the U.S. as part of the solution or as part of the problem? Or how do you make them see the U.S. as part of the solution?
So I think what's very clear, these demonstrations unfolded on October 1st, and they have sustained themselves under the most vicious repression, both by Iraqi security forces and, more importantly, by these militias. It is an extraordinarily young crowd. These are kids, some of them teenagers. A lot of the crowd is 20-somethings. What do they want? They want jobs. They want services. They want an end to the corruption that has really strangled development in their country. They do see the U.S. as part of that solution, but of course, the recent the U.S. killing of Qasem Soleimani and the most powerful militia leader, Iraqi militia leader in Iraq, created a certain churn. And Iraqis in the popular demonstrations are saying, we don't want to be caught in this war between Iran and Iraq. But they are saying they want Iran to get its hands off Iraq. They are not saying that about the U.S.
So if you would be now consulting the U.S. government about Iraq, what would you recommend? What would be the top 3-5 points that you think the U.S. should do now in Iraq?
So look, for Iraq's security and for our security and the security of our wider set of partners and allies, it is critical that we continue with NATO countries and others the training of the Iraqi security forces. That is really quite critical. If the U.S. military trainers leave, you'll see everybody leave. And that is a critical piece still. The fight against ISIS is unfinished business. So that is important. It is important for us to stay the course and build out our relationship with Iraq, to help Iraq be integrated fully into the region. It is
Could that be done with the current Iraqi government?
Well, the current Iraqi government is a caretaker government, and there is a tremendous fight going on between the street and between the political bosses over the next government, over holding early elections. Yes, in effect, Iraq does not need to go back to the bad old days of Saddam Hussein. Iraq can be a good partner, security and otherwise, into its neighborhood. But we have to help them, and the Gulf states have to help them. And that is a piece of diplomatic and political work that I think is quite critical for us to do collectively.
Do you think killing Soleimani does it make a change? Is it a game changer? Has it given more opportunities to change the situation than before? Or?
So when I was in Basra in 2010 to 2011, these militias that Qasem Soleimani created were the ones who were sending rockets and mortars after me and my people. As far as I'm concerned, it would have been a far better thing if he had been taken out on the battlefield in 2006 and 2008. I won't mourn his passing. Will it make a difference in Iran's approach to the region that he has gone? It will. It has created a certain shock. And a certain, it's not disorder. It's a well-oiled machine that he left in Iran and the militias in Iraq. But taking out this Iraqi Abu Mahdi al-Muhandis also dealt a blow to this militia movement. But it is very resilient. The game is not over.
Well, thank you very much. That was very interesting. And thank you for watching. And for more interviews and updates, follow us during the conference on our NSS website. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks.